Like, knowing now what we know about images in the brain, what do we do with that, and how do we make activities that reflect that, and what can we do in a really practical way? Because what I always want in presentations, and the gift of this one being longer, is that we can dive into that research. But what I always want is something practical and tangible to take back to my students. So, in picture talk, which you'll see kind of floating around if you follow the blogs or the Facebook groups or whatever, you'll see people talking about picture talk. Picture talk is just our core TPRS skills. So if you've had TPRS training, if you haven't, we'll go through really quickly what they are. But our core TPRS skills apply to picture. And there are districts that when they have somebody coming in new, and they're saying, we really want you to teach with comprehensible input, or we want you to teach with TPRS. There are a lot of districts now that are going to, starting with picture talk, because this can be a really friendly way to jump in. So if you're pretty new to this, picture talk is great because it gives you some structure. It can be a little bit daunting at the beginning to say, oh, I'm going to ask a story, and like I need to make a story script, or I need to do all these different things to get ready, whereas with a picture, a lot of that is already done for you because the picture is telling part of the story. So if you are interested in kind of diving in, or it's not a beginning skill. Like I don't like to present it that way. It's something that can be really friendly for people starting out. But this is my 12th year of using TPRS, and I use picture talk all the time. So it's not like, oh, this is a step to TPRS stories. This is one more tool in your toolbox, but it's one that might be a little bit easier to learn at the beginning. So if you also have a colleague who's coming in, and if you're more experienced, picture talk can be a great way to say, oh, here's kind of a way for you to begin in a friendly and gentle way. So we're going to apply our skills of circling, personalizing, and story asking. So in circling, step one is we start with a statement. So as we look at this picture, what's a statement that we can make about the picture?
The cat is looking at the mouse.
Yeah, the cat is looking at the mouse. So now we have our two characters that are already here for us. So we have the cat and the mouse. The cat is looking at the mouse. Is the mouse looking at the cat? No. So my example sentence is really similar. We might have the cat sees the mouse, and then you're going to ask a question with a yes answer. So you start with a statement, then you ask a question with a yes answer. So does the cat see? Come on in. Does the cat see the mouse? So now you're going to have this question that has a yes answer. Yes, the cat sees the mouse. And so we started with our statement, the cat is looking at, or the cat sees the mouse. And after that, I want a question with a yes answer. So does the cat see the mouse? Yes, the cat sees the mouse. Now, if I am working with beginning language students, they might be able to just give me a thumbs up for yes. Like if this is the first week of school, it might be a thumbs up. I might just have them say yes in the target language. Or if I'm working with more advanced students, yes, the cat sees the mouse. And honestly, I will often, for the first couple months of school in beginning language classes, take a wide range of answers. So if you just feel comfortable giving a thumbs up, you give a thumbs up. If you want to say yes, you can say yes. If you want to say the whole thing back to me, you can. But I'm always going to say the full answer for the class to give them that whole sentence. So the teacher asks, does the cat see the mouse? And the class can respond with a thumbs up, yes, sees the mouse, cat sees the mouse, the cat sees mouse. And what you'll find is this is a great way of differentiating instruction, because you're high flyers, and I'll even have kids that I know are just really way up here in Spanish, that I'll kind of whisper to them after class, you know, I think you could try to say that whole sentence when I say it. Not that we're forcing output, but just they're ready, and so if they kind of are there. And then for other kids, like, I know that just processing this, when I'm saying it and giving me a thumbs up, that's where they are, and that's totally fine. Language acquisition is happening as they're hearing me. They're getting that input, and the thumbs up, the yes, cat sees the mouse, that cat sees the mouse, all of that is feedback for me that they understood what I said. And in my class, I do have a rule that everyone has to respond in some way every time, whether it's with a thumbs up, whether it's with one word, whether it's with two words, whether it's with the whole sentence. But I'm going to say, so I'll say, does the cat see the mouse? The class gives me thumbs up, yes, whatever their answer is. And then I'll repeat back to them, yes, the cat sees the mouse. So they're hearing that full response every time. Then I'm going to ask an either or question. Does the cat see a mouse, or does the cat see a dog? And whatever the either or is, it's usually something that they already know. And then I come back with, the cat sees a mouse. The cat does not see a dog. This was not something that was done in early TPRS. It's something that's been added in because what people found was that students weren't hearing the negative enough. So we want to say, the cat sees a mouse. The cat does not see a dog. The cat sees a mouse. And I'll go through like the formula for this after this. And then I'm going to ask a question with a no answer. And honestly, this could be my example here is, does the cat see a dog? Because that's kind of like the classic TPRS of like the either or, whatever that was, ask that one. But usually in my own classes, I would say something like, does the mouse see the cat? Because now I'm adding a little bit of tension in. I want them to start thinking about what might happen to that mouse. And then here, no, the cat does not see a dog, the cat sees a mouse. This is the classic model, but what I would do is I would say, no, the mouse does not see the cat. The cat sees the mouse. The mouse does not see the cat. And I want to just add that tension in. So here's our formula. You're going to start with a statement. So our statement was, the cat sees a mouse. Question with a yes answer. And then you're going to restate that answer back to the class every time. Then an either or question, you're going to state the positive, the cat sees a mouse. State the negative, the cat does not see a dog. Restate the positive, the cat sees a mouse. And then question with a no answer, you're going to state the negative. No, the mouse does not see the cat. State the positive, the cat sees the mouse. At the beginning, this can feel really clunky. If you have never been in a TPRS demo in a language that you do not speak, or a language that's not related to your language. So when I sit in a French demo, I go a lot faster than if I sit in a Chinese demo. If you have only sat through a language that's related to your language, or if you've never sat through a demo, this can feel really clunky. But the moment that you go into a demo in Russian, in Chinese, in something that's really different from the language that you teach, you realize how much you need all these repetitions. So especially if you're a native speaker, this is really hard. It's hard to slow yourself down, and it's hard because you're like, yes, by the end, yes, of course the cat sees the mouse. How many times have we said that? But if you're that learner that's sitting there, you need all those repetitions. I just sat through a Chinese demo a couple months ago, and this was just the right challenging pace for me. Like, I felt like I was just kind of getting it, and then we were moving on to the next thing. And this definitely feels, there's a push when you're the learner. So if you have a chance to sit through a language that's not close to yours, do it, because it really illustrates why you need all of these. So go ahead and we're going to break up into groups of 2, 3, 4, and go ahead and do a circling about this picture. So come up with a statement together. a group and ask a yes question. An either or question, state the positive, state the negative, restate the positive, and then a question with a no answer.
So go ahead and practice in groups of, say, 2 to 4.
That's what I was
about for other languages, but you can look at the top 100 or 200 or 300 words
And then the frequency dictionaries, I can't remember, is it 10,000 words that like the Davies, I don't remember. If anybody has one, do you know?
I think it's top 10.
Top 10,000? Yeah. And then there's frequency dictionaries that you can buy. So I have like a frequency dictionary of Spanish, which is a really, if you've never looked at one, it's actually like really convicting because you look at them and you realize that some of the words in the top 100 in our textbook sequence at my school weren't taught till like Spanish 4.
Mm-hmm.
And you think, my gosh. And then they had super low frequency words that didn't even make it into the 10,000 that were introduced in like unit 4. And so that is really, really interesting and like can really, it's really made me wrestle with what we teach and when. You can honestly, this is what I'm finding now as I'm getting more and more comfortable with these skills, you can honestly use almost any vocabulary. I can use incredibly simple vocabulary to make a really compelling story about this picture. So I could use this picture with my kindergartners, and I could use this picture with my Spanish 4 students. It's just what I do with it is going to look different. In kindergarten, it would be something like, this is a dinosaur. Is the dinosaur big, medium, or small? And, you know, what color is the dinosaur? So we're going to get into that. And in Spanish 4, it's going to be much more complex. You know, we're going to get into, like, if you were in the car and a dinosaur were chasing you, what would you do? Would you go fast? Or using that conditional and subjunctive? And so you're getting into, you know, so much more, like, in terms of just complex structures. I don't care if they learn dinosaur, but I do care that they learn those high-frequency words around it. And so, like, the dinosaur sees the car, or something that sees is a really high-frequency word. And the dinosaur, you know, is he hungry or is he not hungry? And so you can really honestly use this for almost anything. And dinosaur is what I almost think of as like my Trojan horse to get in. I need classes that are not just comprehensible but also compelling. So how do I make that compelling? I sacrifice a little bit of high-frequency vocab to have one of our main characters be a dinosaur. And then I pack in a bunch of high-frequency vocabulary around that. So hopefully that will answer that question. No more than 3 to 5 new structures as a general rule of thumb. Once again, there's always kind of, you can play with it, but generally speaking. And then, you're right, dinosaur is not a high-frequency word, but it's my way of kind of sneaking in some high-frequency vocabulary in a really compelling way. Were there other questions that came up while you were doing this? One question that comes up a lot is how much time you spend on this, and it really depends. You can use this as a 5 or 10 minute thing, or you can use it as an entire class period, and I have had times where with a picture talk, generally with kindergartners, I try to keep my activities no longer than about 5 or 6 minutes just because of attention span, or put a brain break in there for them so they're getting up and moving around and then sitting back down. But I've had times where they were so hooked into an activity that we just kept it going for 20 or 25 minutes with no brain break because they were so into it. And so it really depends, like if you have a certain amount of stuff that you need to get through in a, you know, in a class period, then you can say, okay, I'm gonna take 8 minutes for picture talk. But really you can spread it out over a whole class period. It's really nice when it's like, or if it's about 25 minutes to half an hour, that's a really nice length for a picture talk. And there's many different things you can do with it that we're gonna talk about. And once again, you're going to introduce this with one image and then the spoken, and then you're going to want to write it down. And so what I usually do is once we've asked a story about this dinosaur who's chasing this car, what that story looks like is going to be different, you know, based on your level. So there's a dinosaur. He is big. He's green. He's hungry. That's like level one. And then, you know, if you were in the car, what would you do is more of a higher level. What I'll usually do is I'll ask questions about the story, and I actually, there are many different personalities that teach with TPRS. Some of them are really loud and they're in the center of the room all the time. I tend to be quietly sitting in my chair a lot of the time, but while I'm asking questions about this, I'll usually type it up as the class is answering, and then at the end of the class, I just hit print and make photocopies. The next time we come into class, we all have a reading that's based on what we did. At that point, I will show them the text and the image together because that like is kind of a nice memory jog for them. They come in, they see that dinosaur, like, oh yeah, dinosaur story. And they'll sit down and we'll even just do that as a warm-up to read and then answer some questions about it. Or you can assign it as homework, or you can add it to your free voluntary reading library. And so there's many different things that you can do. So I like to just type it. I don't have time in my day to type it after class, so I like to just type it as the class is creating it. You can, if you teach older students, you can assign a secretary to do this. I usually just do it myself because I teach mostly younger kids. But it's a really quick way of then creating a reading just as part of your natural lesson plan. And you're doing enough circling and, you know, going back and asking questions that I always have time to type the answers. So that's our first Tiberias skill.
I have a question. Yes. So what do you do if you've got several different sections of the same course?
So I guide it. So this is where I actually told this to Blaine right a couple months ago, and he laughed really hard. I thought at the beginning that you couldn't say no in Tiberias. I thought you just had to take the story where the kids wanted to go, and Blaine was like, my gosh, then this would have been just pure chaos. It's like it was for like 2 years. And so I realized that I could say no. And so I can guide them. Like, I don't care what the name of the dinosaur is, and I don't really care if you know, he's big, medium, or small, and I don't really care if, you know, there's many pieces of the story that I don't care about. But I do kind of want him to maybe be running fast after a car, and I don't care who's in the car, I don't care what type of car it is, I don't care what color the car is. So I kind of, like, will look at a picture before class and think about what are the structures that I really am interested in for this picture, and then what's the stuff that I don't care about, and I'll kind of lead and guide the story. So I'll say something like, I don't know, where are they going? And the kids can decide, you know, oh, they're going to Minneapolis, or they're going to Canada, or they're going to the moon, or, you know, what, it's a magical car, it's going to the moon. I don't care if, like, that piece is different from class to class, but there are certain things that are going to remain the same. And honestly, I don't have to guide it that much with a picture, because this picture's already telling enough of a story, and the kinds of questions that I ask about it can kind of guide it. So it's really an interplay. It really is co-creating. So there really is a part that is where I want it to go, and then there's a part that the kids are creating along with it. So there will be some details that are different from class to class, but the great part is they all want to know what the other class did. So a lot of times I'll have all of them as options for them to read the next time they come in. So I'll have them start out with the one that we did as a class, and then either if they get done, they can read the next one, or I'll add, like, the other classes to our free voluntary reading library, or we'll go through all three of them together as a class. So here's what the other Spanish 1 classes did, and then compare and contrast, and there's many questions that you can ask with that. Yes?
So when you type these up, you type what the teacher says, so is it like a dialogue format, or how does it look?
Yeah, so I'll just type the story, so I don't type all the questions along with it. So I'll say, oh, there's a dinosaur. Now, what's the dinosaur's name? The dinosaur's name is Fred. And so then in my thing, as I'm like, is the dinosaur's name Fred or Joe? Like, I'm typing in the thing, the dinosaur's name is Fred. One really quick thing, too, that was a huge pitfall that I fell into at the beginning is you only use this circling process for new vocabulary words and structures. So when I first started out, we spent like 6 months circling, like, is his name Fred or is his name Joe? And the kids were so over it. They were so sick of circling. So you want to make sure that you're only using this questioning thing with new words and phrases. So that being said, I'm going to have a little less time at the beginning because we're not going to circle. After the first couple weeks or the first month or so, I'm no longer going to be circling his name is. So then what I'll do sometimes is I'll have the bare bones of the story typed up beforehand, and I'll just kind of insert and add any little extra details. So there's a dinosaur, the dinosaur's name is, and then I'll just quickly type in Fred. And then, so I'll do both. So one strategy is at the beginning, during circling gives me time to type. Another thing is have like the bare bones of the story beforehand and type it in. And then the third strategy is, honestly, you can take a little bit of a pause. That actually gives those kids, especially the kids that have an auditory processing thing going on, giving them a little 10 to 15 second pause is not, you don't want to do it after every sentence, but once in a while, if you need to catch up on typing, you can just recap some of the stuff. So you can either take a pause or you can recap, like, oh, so there's a dinosaur and his name is Fred. And I'll sometimes throw something that's wrong in there. And Fred is really small. And the class is like, no, Fred is really big. And so then I'll like throw some misinformation in there as I'm continuing to type. So you can give a little pause. You can recap. And sometimes purposely give wrong info. The other thing is sometimes I will go off of this slide and I'll just type it up and have the class read it chorally. And so we're leaving the image for a second. This is especially great if you have a language where you want to spend a little more time on spelling. So you can switch slides. Students read orally as you type. So that's another option. Or you can read it aloud to them as you type. If they're pretty beginners in the language, you can be reading it as you type, and then you can pause and ask them questions about it. So our next speaker has a skill. Oh, just really quickly, any more questions about circling before? So remember, we circle only for new words and structures. So that means we're only going to be going through that circling process for maybe about 3 new words or structures in a story. The next thing is personalizing. So I'm going to maybe show this picture of a girl that has a lion. This is great for elementary. And then I'm going to go and say, like, the lion is her pet, and then I might ask a student if they have a pet. So, Sam, do you have a pet? And Sam says, yes. And then I'll ask him, like, do you have a lion, like the girl in the picture? And once again, that picture's going to still be up there. And then Sam's going to say, he doesn't have a lion, unless Sam says he does have a lion. In Spanish class, anything is possible. I have told them as long as they are answering the question, they can answer it however they want to. And I've told them, if you want to tell me that you have a blue dragon that, you know, lives in your refrigerator, like, that's awesome. You can have that in Spanish class. And I hand out surveys to my students, ask, like, a check-in, like, how am I teaching? Because they're the experts on my teaching. They watch me more than anyone else. And so every semester I hand out a survey to them about things I could do better, things they like, things they didn't like. And one of my fourth graders wrote this year on her fall semester, my favorite thing about Spanish is that it's an imaginary world where anything is possible. And I love that. It gives them the power to be outside of, even if they come from a really happy home and a really happy family, like, still having that power to be whatever you want to be in Spanish is really cool for them, and they enjoy it. It's a space where they feel like they have some ownership and they have some ability to dream and be a little silly. So maybe Sam does have a lion for the purpose of this example. We'll say that Sam doesn't, and I'll ask him what pet he does have, and Sam says he has a cat. And so if Sam, so in this, I might be focusing in an elementary class on the word pet, and so that might be kind of what I'm getting at here. They already may know the word for lion. Once again, lion is not a super high frequency word, but it's a compelling picture that allows me to bring in some of the stuff that's much more high frequency. Do you have, I have, he has, she has. And so Sam has a cat. And now I'm going to say, oh, class, Sam has a cat. Sam does not have a lion. Sam has a cat. Unless Sam has said he does have a lion. Then I'm going to say, oh, the girl in this picture has a lion. Sam has a lion. This lion is yellow. Sam, what color is your lion? Sam's like, I have a green lion. Oh, Sam has a green lion. This girl has a yellow lion. And so then you can kind of go off of that. In this thing, I would be focusing most on pet and have. So think of how many repetitions. I don't care what the actual animal is, but think of how many repetitions I'm getting of different forms of have. And then I'm going to ask somebody else, Ava, do you have a lion? And Ava says, no, she has a dog. And it might be that Sam has a lion, the girl in the picture has a lion, and Ava has a dog, but I can still do this wonderful comparing and contrasting. So the end goal is to compare and contrast, giving different forms of that structure have, I have, you have, he or she has, and then maybe practicing with that word pet a little bit. But the whole idea is that this is kind of a way of sneaking in that high frequency vocabulary in a really compelling way. So we have circling, we have personalizing. So personalizing is just bringing our students' own likes, interests, ideas, experiences. So it doesn't have to be what do you have at your house, like do you have a pet? It can be do you like ice cream? Do you like pizza with, I don't know, onions and mushrooms? It can be whatever it is that we want to ask them. And as once again, that vocabulary is going to get more and more complex as we go up into the higher levels. So if you were to, would you, have you ever, and things like that. So this is pretty basic, but people always ask, well, how do you do this in the upper levels? You just amp it up. You make it so that you're using more and more of these different structures and you're making more and more complex sentences. So here are the ways to use picture talk. And we're going to get into some other kind of Teacher S&CI skills as we go through. But here's the ways that you can use a picture talk where you are circling and you're personalizing and then you're going to ask different questions about an image. So you can use it, number one, as the launch pad for a story. So when we saw that dinosaur chasing after that car, that's a story that we can really easily tell in class. And so that is, you know, what is happening to the people in the car? Why is the dinosaur chasing? Is he hungry? Is he angry? Does he want to ride? Where does he want to go? And then when we have the cat and the mouse, that's also a story. So we have the cat looking at the mouse, who has no idea that the cat is there. And that is instantly compelling for my students. If you have that on the board when they come in, they're instantly going to start talking about, like, oh, he sees him, and he doesn't need to see him, and what's going to happen, and is he going to eat him? And there's already kind of some built-in conflict there. So you can use it as the launch pad for an entire story. But you can also use it to expand a story. And we'll go into the specifics of how to do that. You can use it as a hook into your lesson. So once again, that's where you have it on the board as the kids are coming in and they're already excited about what you're going to do that day because there's something interesting up on the board. You can use images as a culture pop-up, and we'll look at that as the basis for a whole culture discussion. That could take like an entire class period or half a class period. And then you can use it to jog your students' memory about something, and I'll share a little bit more about how to do that in our kind of toward the end of the session today. So activity one is a story. Excuse me.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
So when you're doing the personalizing, when you see the whole thing with Lion, it's a cognate.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't it okay because the kids are going to understand it?
Most of them will. I am constantly amazed in a class of, you know, I don't know, 30 kids, 29 will hear the chocolate and chocolate, and one will not hear the chocolate and chocolate. And so yes, you can, and TPRS readers do this a lot. They rely a lot on cognates. For the vast majority of your kids, I think a cognate can be pretty, like, robots for robots. I have always found there's one kid that doesn't hear it. So I still will establish meaning, like, León means lion, and I'll have that on the board, and when I use León, now if you teach younger kids, if you teach pre-literate students, I can tell you the strategies that I use for them, and I can't write it on the board, but I'm going to go off the assumption most of you are working with kids who know how to read, and if you don't, come talk to me. But then when I say León for the first at least couple of times, I'm going to point, even if it's a cognate. They probably are going to get it a little bit faster than a word that's completely not a cognate. But I, at the beginning, really relied a lot on cognates. And the longer I teach with this, the more I realize that there's always kids that don't hear it. So, yeah, it's really fascinating.
And I guess my other question was, what if then when you're asking that kid what animal they have, what if they answer you in English?
Yeah, so
then you rephrase?
Then I rephrase, yeah.
Okay.
So maybe they have, you know, a Komodo dragon or something, and they don't know how to say, or they wish they had one, and they don't know how to say that. Or, and I've learned words. I had a kid a couple years ago that said, I would really like to have a quoll. I said, what in the world is a quoll?
Mm-hmm.
And so we looked up what a quoll was. It's an animal that lives in Australia. And we all learned about quolls, and then I was like, how do you say quoll? And so it's el quoll. But, so I learned a new word. And yeah, so And that's why I will only have, and I don't count those words as like my 3 to 5. I don't really care if they fully acquire them. But I'll put them up on the board and point to them. And yeah, it's fine if they, I tell them if you know the word in Spanish, answer in Spanish. If you don't, it's okay during that personalizing time. But you do have to kind of set up a thing that you can't tell me a whole story about it. Like it's a quick answer back in Spanish. So that's part of my procedures at the beginning of the year for high school and for younger kids, that when I ask you a question, like answer with a pretty concise guide. I don't, like we don't have the class time to hear, as much as I'm sure it's interesting, you know, your entire story about how when you went to the beach, you know, you saw this, it's gotta be kind of quick. So, does that seem, okay. So the first activity is a story. If you want to base a story on an image, you need to really pick carefully an image that already pulls you into a story. And as I'm going around Facebook, as things are shared from like Bored Panda, or as things are shared, like whenever I come across a compelling image, I just bookmark it. All the ones in this presentation pretty much are from a website that's called Pixabay that has up on, was up on the board, that is clickable in my notes, that's free for educational and commercial use. You do have to be careful about copyright. We'll talk about copyright. But it's really important to use an image that pulls people in. So here, if I'm going to ask a story, so asking a story basically just means that I'm asking questions and my students are getting answers. And once again, at the beginning, I thought that I had to take any answer they gave. I was incredibly empowered. It was Stephen Krashen, actually, that told me I could say no. I was doing this for a couple of years, and I saw Stephen Krashen at a seminar that he was giving for elementary teachers, and I, like, popped in during, like, intermission, and I went up to him, and I was like, I am really struggling with my story just spiraling out of control. And he looked at me and goes, well, you can say no. And that was so empowering. I did not know that before, so you can say no. So when you're asking a story, you're going to start with your character. And so you've got the who here. So we have a dog. And maybe the who is, you know, who's the dog? What's his name? In the lower level classes, what color is he? Is he big, medium, or small? Is he a nice dog? Is he a mean dog? And then we can also get into who is he waiting for? Is he waiting for his owner? Is he waiting for an adult? Is he waiting for a child? How old are they? So I can spend a lot of time just on the who. Then I'm going to get into where. And this is where the story can really change, and this is where I'm most likely to say no. Maybe he's waiting outside of a school. Maybe there's a child that's going to come after school, and they're going to go play, and he's really excited. Or maybe he's waiting outside of a store, and like his favorite doggy treats are in there, and he's so excited to get a dog treat when his owner comes out. Or maybe he's waiting outside of a hospital. And how does that change the story if he's waiting outside? And this is where, like I said, I'm most likely to have a place in mind just for where I kind of want to go with it. There's times when I let the class be pretty free with it, but most of the time I have kind of a structure in the back of my head of where I want it to go. And then we want to give some conflict, we want to give a problem. So maybe the store is out of dog treats, and that's the problem. He's hungry and he's sad, he doesn't get a dog treat, so they go to another store. Or maybe he's been waiting forever and the child isn't coming out yet, and he's a dog, so he doesn't have a really good sense of time, but he's just so anxious to go play and he's wondering where the child is. Maybe he actually goes in the school, like maybe someone opens the door, like a teacher or something, and he gets in the school and he goes looking, and he looks in the cafeteria and he looks in the library. If you are required to teach places around a school, that's a really good way to do it in a compelling way. Or maybe the problem is that his owner's sick and he's been waiting out here for a really long time. And so you can really take this so many different directions. And then related to that is the why. So why is he waiting? Why does he want to get in? Why does he want to, you know, or why do they have to go to another place to get dog treats? Why is he there? And that is often answered in your other ones. And then how I won't go through all of these every single time, but if you want to, like, how does he get in the building, the door opens, or how does he feel? And so that is, and you can do how long, how many, how much, how many dog treats does he want, how long has he been there? So you can go through really all of those H and WH questions, and really how many of them you go through really depends on kind of how long you want to spend on this activity, how complex of a story you want to do, and kind of where you want the story to go. But you can circle as you're doing that, so you're going to circle your new words and phrases. You're going to personalize by asking students, like, oh, do you have a dog, and does your dog ever come to school, does your dog wait outside, oh, your dog waits in the car when your parents pick you up from carpool, and so you can bring in, do you have a dog, where do you buy dog treats for your dog, you can bring in any kind of their own personal experience that you want to. And so you circle your new phrases, your new structures, you personalize, bringing students' experiences in, and then you're going to ask the story with these H and WH questions. So go ahead, and I'm going to give you, wow, none of this is working today. This is so weird. I was like, this happened to me the last time I presented, and so I tested it 3 days ago in presentation mode, and it worked. And so there must be something weird about being hooked up to the, I have no idea. So anyway, I was just going to give you a 3-minute countdown to ask.
Is the projector volume on?
You know, it's not a volume thing. It's the,
But if the projector volume is muted.
Yeah, maybe that's it. But this is supposed to just play at like a timer countdown. But yeah, I don't know. Let's see if, looks like volume's at max. That's okay. I can, yeah, it's just saying like multimedia, not sound weird. Okay, but I'm going to give you 3 minutes to go ahead and just based on this picture, ask, start with who, and then you might go to where. So we always start with who, we always establish our character, but after that I play with it a little bit. So you can do where, why, how many, what, when, and so on. So I'm going to give you guys 3 minutes to, in groups, come up with just a little story about this dog and what's going on with him. So 3 minutes to practice in groups of 3 or 4, and then we'll kind of talk about how you can circle and personalize with that.
You're good.
Why did he set up his shell?
you did that.
So the Xi'an is what we're trying to say. So the Xi'an book.
You can take, once again, it depends on how much time you want to spend.
And you, usually you'll find that as you're personalizing, oh, so-and-so does have a cabin in Ely. Oh, they're so lucky. You know, you can really, you know, as long as your class is really into it, you can keep going with it. And the moment that you kind of see that people are starting to, you know, move around a little bit, then you can bring it back to having the story move forward. So there's classes that I can just add so many different details, and then there's classes that I need to keep it really moving. And the great thing is if I do have a class where I can add some more details, I can bring those in when we read each other's stories. If they're all like four sections of level one, remember I'm going to use those stories to compare and contrast. We're all going to read what everybody has done. And so that works really well. So Charlie's at a cabin in Minnesota, and Charlie has a problem. Now, this is where I might guide the story. If I ask, what is Charlie's problem, that is a hugely open-ended question. And I may get some answers back that I feel like I need to just move past really quickly. So I'm going to tell you that Charlie has a problem, and Charlie's hungry. And so from there, once again, you can choose to guide or not guide. I know that with the problem, it's good for me to guide it. You know, Charlie wants to eat. What does Charlie want to eat? And then I heard one thing that I hadn't heard in presenting this before, that that's actually the cat's dish and not Charlie's, which I wrote down. That was very creative. And so you can take it that way. And sometimes, you know, your kids are going to come up with something where you think, oh, the story is going this way. And someone's going to blurt something out, and you're going to be like, that is the most creative thing ever. We're going to go with that. Mm-hmm. And there's still a way to kind of maneuver the story in that way. So Charlie is at a cabin in Minnesota. You can go where the cabin is located, if the cabin is big, medium, or small. If how much time does Charlie spend at the cabin? Is it his cabin or someone else's cabin? You can just add so many different details. And then Charlie has a problem. Charlie is hungry. You can have some conflict in here. The cat always has food, but Charlie doesn't have food. You can also talk about what Charlie wants to eat. This is a great picture to use with that class that you teach right before lunch, because there's a lot of like just empathy and like shared experience with Charlie. And sometimes I've actually used this picture to like then pull up the lunch menu and talk about what's for lunch that day. And oh, does Charlie want to eat, you know, chicken fingers, or does Charlie not want to eat chicken fingers? And who here likes that lunch? And you can go through so many things to bring it into your students' own, you know, shared experience with Charlie. And so then maybe Charlie goes to different family members and asks, like, begs for food from all of them, and they all say no. Like, and then maybe one wonderful family member gives Charlie, you know, a hamburger, whatever it is that he wanted, and Charlie is happy, and that's his favorite member of the family, or kind of however you want to structure it. But generally, you want to introduce your character. You're going to ask your questions there. I don't ever go through all the questions, but, you know, if you have, oh, Charlie wants to eat a hamburger, how many hamburgers does Charlie want to eat? And you can take silly questions or silly answers. Charlie wants to eat 100 hamburgers. Or you can take more reasonable like answers, like Charlie wants to eat 2. And really, as you go through and ask these questions with your class, you can guide it as much as you want to. I usually have a really nice balance of things that I've decided in advance that I want and things that they can do and that I've left a little bit more open-ended for them. And as you go through the story, you are really creating together. So you're going to start with your picture. You're going to ask your who, what, when, where, why, how questions. Some of those questions you'll have answers to already in the back of your head. You'll guide your class there. Some of them, you'll let them just pick themselves. Sometimes they'll surprise you with something and you'll go that direction with the story instead because you realize that's a better story than one that I could create. And then you're going to circle your new vocabulary and grammar structures. You're going to personalize, bring in your kids' own experiences, and that's really the process of co-creating a story. And it can be just a really friendly way to do it with an image because you have that structure there. So Stephen Krashen says, language acquisition proceeds best when the input is not only comprehensible, but really interesting, even compelling. So interesting that you forget you are listening to or reading another language. And in a TPRS class, we have moments like this all the time, where I look out and I see kids are so excited, and they've really forgotten in the fun of the moment that we're doing it all in the target language. And that's where it becomes really important to pick images that are really compelling. Like I said, I get most of my images from Pixabay. So I'm going to just run through a couple other options. So here we have this, and it's hard to see because of the lights on in here, but we have this kind of interesting planet and just this very solitary character standing here. This is a picture that's compelling. It pulls you in to a story, and it makes it possible to tell a story that, you know, you've got kids that are really into sci-fi in your classes, and how do you tell a story in level one, or ask a story in level one that's really like sci-fi in nature, if that's what they're really into? Well, you can do it with an image. You don't have to have any special sci-fi vocabulary, but here we have this man, and he's alone, and what is he looking for? And you can tell that story that just happens to be set here and uses a lot of high-frequency vocabulary. My fourth grade students are really into these Photoshop animal hybrids. This was incredibly popular. We ended the year with this one in one of my fourth grade classes, and they love these. If you've got kids like fifth, sixth, seventh grade, I haven't tried these with my high schoolers, but they might be very popular in high school too. But certainly like upper elementary, lower middle school, these are highly, highly engaging. Here's another one. It's really fun. These are just super fun characters. They lend themselves to level one really well because of the amount of describing that you can do.
And where did you say you got those?
Those are all from Pixabay too. Here's another fun one. This one is interesting. What can you do with this one? Like, there's many different ways that you can go with this particular image. Here's another one. So you want an image that's going to pull you in, makes you want to know more. So here's one place that I get images. I talked about Pixabay, but one other spot where I get images is from Children's Book Illustrator websites. And we're going to actually look at this after the break, where I get images, and then some other practical activities. So now we've got the basics of picture talk, and then how do we do that for different activities. So I'm going to give you another 5-minute break. Hop into another session if you want to. Come back here if you want to see some other ways to use this. Especially in terms of culture, this is kind of like we've looked at the research, we've looked at the basics, and now this is kind of taking it one step further. And so we'll do that for the final hour. So take 5 minutes. Thank you.
So we're going to have edits.
For the summers, we can just click, we don't have to write this out.
Yes.